get going with today's formalities, a few things. We're always on the lookout for topics, volunteers, so if you're interested, feel free to join. Second, for formality, please silence your mobile phones, put them on vibrate mode or whatever. Does anyone have any job announcements to make? Oh, sorry, I forgot the formality myself. My name is MP DeMarco. I'm the vice chair. Brian, who's the chair, he's out on travel, so he's not here today. Let me recognize a few volunteers of IEEE PELPS. There is Kevin back there, who's doing the videography and photography. There's Renee back there, and there's Doug and Mike, and I forgot one more name. Ed, sorry. My IOG, former colleague. Nice of you to help out. Before we get going with the program today, we have a public service type of activity. We have David Towles from NCORE. NCORE is a NGO, non-governmental organization that does promotion of STEM education. So let me yield the floor to David. He's going to say a few words about what his organization does. And then after that, Jeff Nillis, who is the MC for today, is going to come up and interview the speakers and then take the program through. Oh, by the way, regarding another formality, if you got any quick questions, feel free to raise your hand and get it clarified. But generally, we hold the Q&A towards the end of the program. So with that, let me bring David to the floor.
Thank you so much. All right. Hello, everybody. I'm probably the only non-engineer in the room. I am a school teacher by trade, and I studied psychology and neuroscience as an undergrad. So what you do amazes me, and I can't hope to understand it, but maybe I'll learn a little bit today. So the slideshow is coming up, and as my introducer said, NCORE is a nonprofit, and our mission is to get STEM professionals involved in public education, public STEM education, especially in high-need schools. So I'm here to tell you a little bit about our program. It's really an awareness campaign, and if any of you are interested, I'm going to be at that table over there, and we can talk afterwards. I'm under a pretty big time crunch here, so I'm going to move pretty fast. Is there a slide advancer up here? Ah, okay. Thank you. All right. Oh, there was one. Okay. So a little bit about myself. That's me teaching the tender age of 25. Like I said, I studied psychology, and then I became a school teacher. I taught in Boston Public Schools, which was not at all like the TV show. And then after that, I taught in San Francisco. I co-founded and ran a nonprofit, and now I'm helping STEM professionals explore and sometimes even make a career change into teaching, which is pretty cool. And why would you want to do this? Certainly not for the money. I think at the core, there's an existential moment everyone has, and they say to themselves, what am I leaving behind? How am I making the world a better place? And that, to me, is really it. A lot of folks I talk to have a desire to give back, to have this great knowledge. They want to share it. On top of that, we see there's a crisis level of STEM education in the country, and that there is an enormous teacher shortage. And this double whammy is causing things to go really badly for a lot of the kids out there that want to become engineers like you. Okay, we're seeing that test scores are disproportionately skewed towards certain racial groups, that is across the board, not just for math and science, but it's most extreme in math and science. Overall, we have a 37% proficiency in math in this state, and that's for every student in public school. 37%, that's not good. If we look at data that compares socioeconomic groups, we see that there's a dotted line which represents the kids that get free and reduced lunch. Compare that to the kids who don't receive free and reduced lunch, and there's a disparity between the poor kids and the not poor kids. And you should be thinking to yourself, why do the poor kids do so much worse in math class? Is it because they're poor? There is a correlation, and it's a really unfortunate one, but you should be saying, gosh, that's not right. We see a leaky pipeline, too. We have half a million people start ninth grade every year in this state. And through the different stages of going through their schooling, when they come out of undergrad, only 4% of those half a million graduate with a STEM degree. And that's not about aptitude. That's just about interest. You know, that's about, is this something that's engaged them at some point in their schooling? And it's a really low number, right? There's also disparities in representation in undergrad and in grad school for certain racial groups and in the job market. This probably isn't a surprise to you. The double whammy, though, is that the teaching force, the thing that would make this better, has been dwindling, and we're in the middle of a huge teacher crisis right now. Demand is outstripping supply. It's expected to get worse. There's been a little uptick, but it's really not getting to where it needs to be. Last year, there was 21,000 classrooms in the state that did not have a qualified teacher in them at the start of the year. Multiply that by 25 to 30 kids in each class, and you're dealing with a huge amount of our population that is not getting educated. What's the solution? How do we solve this? Well, there's a lot of people looking at undergrads and saying, oh yeah, have the 22-year-olds go in there and really change things around. We're saying no, it's STEM professionals, right? Folks like yourselves who have the expertise in the field and the knowledge in what you do, you're in a great position to give back. And these are some of the fellows in our program, right? And so this guy, Keith, he's one of you, right? He, I believe, was a professor of, I don't even remember, but he is now teaching middle school. And through our program, in our history, we've served over 35,000 students. And I think that's really powerful. So here's some other folks, more local. We have Brian on one end who decided to actually switch careers, and he jumped the track and got his credential, and he's now teaching physics and engineering, which is really cool. Lori, through our program, tried things out, decided that full-time teaching really wasn't her thing, but she really enjoys volunteering still, and she enjoys the support we give her to do it. Okay, why are STEM professionals our answer? Well, you know your stuff, right? There's no question about your content knowledge. When I went in and taught biology, I never had a biology degree, and even though I could get by, there were some questions I hadn't studied in depth. But if someone comes to you with a question about, you know, Ohm's law, you have it. It's there. You're also passionate about it. This is what you've done professionally. You can speak with a great deal of authority about it. You can answer the question of relevance. A kid will always say, well, I don't need to know this. I'm not going to do that with my future. And you can say, well, actually, here's what you do need to know to get you to where I was. And I'm not just telling you that. I'm telling, like, I live this. And you can too, right? You can serve as a role model. A lot of these kids have never met an engineer before. They don't think it's for them. They think it's for someone else. And you can tell them different, right? And you also have access to opportunities and field trips and guest speakers and materials that teachers like me never could. So for all these reasons, it's really compelling to think about STEM professionals working with students in K-12 education. And that's what our nonprofit does, right? We start with your desire to give back. We realize this might be a solution for the teacher shortage, and it would solve this achievement gap that I've demonstrated. There's also some ancillary things that happen. By virtue of getting involved in public education, the elevation of the prestige of the profession has been elevated. It's possible that the inefficiencies in the system that engineers are so good at solving will be solved. There is content support for teachers who might not know as much about the technical side of things as you. And there's also community engagement, right? And there's even bigger picture stuff that can happen. There's an encounter between folks that never would talk to each other. And it's a shame to me that there's, you know, segments of our society and our community that really miss each other. This is a way to connect those dots, right? It's also true that we can promote women, minorities, and folks that are lower income in STEM fields. And we also have increased access and opportunity for all the folks that you might be working with. So there's a lot that can come from your individual desire to give back. I'm not going to belabor our program nuts and bolts, but know that we have a laid out pathway for people that they can make choices. And some people choose to go get teaching credentials and become teachers. This is really popular for folks in retirement or early retirement. But if you just want to volunteer and get added support and be part of our community, that's fine too. We give you immediate access to working with students. We have a mentorship, both from myself as the director and a former school teacher, as well as the teachers we place you with, who all say, yes, I would love to host them in my classroom. If you choose to get a credential, we give you support around that, all the exams you need to take, guidance on financial aid, things like that. We actually provide some scholarships for people. When it's time to find a job, we give you a chance to network with schools. I have probably, even right now, an email or two a week asking, who do you have that can teach physics? I need an engineering teacher. I need a chemistry teacher. Who do you have? Please send someone over. So it's pretty easy to find work in the teaching profession if that's what you choose to do. We also give a lot of professional development. And these are not dry lecture-style events. We do activities. So here we are building things that you can use. I think this was a cardboard chair challenge. And the process of inquiry that you learned through that, that activity was something you could use with kids. And finally, we have a cohort of people that you can bounce ideas off of, right? These are all folks such as you who are working in STEM professions who have said to themselves, I really want to explore teaching and get involved in K-12 education. And it's great to have this community to compare notes with and get ideas from and such. This is not something you have to travel far to do. So we'll have schools nearby. And a lot of people say, I'm not going to cross a bridge. I won't get on the highway at rush hour. I don't blame you. You won't have to do that. So there's a lot of schools on this list that are very close. Most recently, I'm excited about the 49ers STEM Leadership Institute in Santa Clara. It's a really cool spot. Their makerspace is amazing. So we have two start times during the year, and right now we're actually accepting applications for a January start. And if you wanted to hold out and kind of take our traditional start, we do have one in the summer, which starts the next school year. There are some expectations that we have for our program, and I'm sure you have a bunch of questions, but I don't have much time to tell you about them. So what I'm going to tell you is that I'm going to be over there. I have a copy of this presentation, and thank you to Doug for printing that out. You can take that with you. You can take a brochure and a card, and know that there's a lot of kids out there that really do need your help. I would love for you to apply to our fellowship. It's a free part-time thing. You can do it while you're still working. And again, this is one of the only nonprofits I know that focuses on STEM professionals, getting them involved in public education. Okay? That's the URL to apply. Questions I'll take later. Our deadline's at the end of November, and I thank you so much for your time.
So I'm Jeff Nellis. I'm a treasurer in this local Pels organization. So a couple things coming up. There's an IEEE senior advancement meeting. I believe it's being held here in November 15th. You can check it out on the grid. And also, we've moved our meeting up for November from the fourth Thursday of the month up to the third Thursday of the month because of Thanksgiving. And so on our next meeting, we're going to have Professor Seth Sanders out of Berkeley come and speak. I think I'm known Professor Sanders for at least 25 years or something like that. So, and then the other part is on Pradeep's presentation, we're going to be recording it, and I think we're going to put it on our local Pels website. So just search for SF Bay Area Pels IEEE. So Pradeep is our guest speaker today. He's one of the more active IEEE members that I know of. I think when he came out of with his PhD out of Urbana-Champaign, I think he got right into the IEEE right away. I know he's done things like he was a student leadership for Pels nationwide. He's been active on APEC. I know he's worked on committees before this year. He's also on the committee and he's also on the administrative committee for IEEE Power Society. So you'll see him around a lot. He's published a lot if you check out APEC papers. So welcome, Pradeep. And one other thing for those who came in late, make sure you shut these off. Robert, next.
Hi everyone, how are you doing tonight?
Pretty good.
Good. Looks like this is hot, so that's good. Am I supposed to use number one or number two? Doesn't matter? Okay, who does number two work for? Me tonight. So what I have the pleasure of sharing with you guys today is, can you hear me okay? Okay, good. Is a little bit about some work that I've done over the last couple years since joining Texas Instruments. I'm from Dallas. I'm not actually from here in the Bay Area. I happened to be visiting this week, and I got in touch with the leadership of the Power Electronics Society here, and that's why I'm giving this talk here today. But at TI, I work
as a systems engineer in our point of load DC to DC converter group called the Swift product line. And we try to make high efficiency, high density DC to DC converters specifically used for point of load voltage regulator applications. And I think it was April of this year, we released a new DC to DC converter that uses a new topology that enables very small, low profile voltage regulators. And that's basically what I'm going to discuss today. Now, I'm assuming most of you guys know the basic power delivery system that is in a lot of pieces of equipment today. Depends on the application. This is just one that you might see in, like, let's say a computer server or something like that, where connected to the AC input, you'll have some sort of power supply. The output of that power supply will be some intermediate bus, let's say 12 volts. That's a very common bus voltage. And then you have these non-isolated DC to DC converters that convert from 12 volts down to whatever your load voltage is. Let's say 1.2, 1 volt, 1.5 volt, something like that. Typically, these are powering some sort of digital circuit, maybe a microprocessor, maybe it could be DDR memory, it could be a variety of things. What is the conventional topology that's used today is a buck converter, and I'm sure you guys, since you're here, are familiar with that. The thing that I want to highlight from this is that these buck converters, these point of load voltage regulators, they typically have high voltage conversion ratios. In this case, it's 12 volt input and let's say 1.2 volts output. So that's a 10 to 1 voltage conversion ratio. It turns out buck converters aren't actually a great topology for doing high voltage conversion ratio applications. You're not really utilizing your FETs very well, and you can do better. Now, a major goal that we always try to do in power electronics, and I'm assuming all of you here know a thing or two about power electronics since you're at the Power Electronics Society meeting, so I'm not going to go into like the basic details. But just as background, the main reasons why as power electronics engineers we usually try to increase switching frequency, first off, we want to reduce size. On the left, this is like your conventional buck converter designed for, let's say, 12 volts in, 10 amps out, and let's say it's operating around 500 kilohertz. If you were to instead operate that same 12 volt in, 10 amp converter at higher frequency, you can reduce its size. And this is a picture of the converter that is right here, and I'll pass this around in just a little bit so you can see how small that is. This is using a new DC-DC converter topology called a series capacitor buck converter, and I'll tell you more about that. But as you can see, the largest component is usually an inductor in these applications. You also have a bit of input and output capacitance. So basically, if you look at what takes up most of the space in these converters, it's not the silicon, it's not the IC, it's the passive components around it. And in this example, one thing that's interesting that I think is pretty cool is this converter, its total volume is 157 millimeters cubed, whereas this converter on the left over here, just the inductor used is larger than that. So the focus for that of our effort that we were trying to do was to reduce size. It turns out when you go to higher frequency, you get some other benefits. One of the major benefits is a faster transient response. So you get better performance. Whenever your load current changes really quickly, you can respond to those changes in current much more quickly. You also have the potential to reduce your bill of material costs because you're using smaller inductors and fewer capacitors. And the title of this talk was, you know, the technology behind the world's smallest 12 volt 10 amp power converter or something like that, I think. Can't remember exactly what I titled it. So I need to kind of prove that statement, and hopefully this is the justification for that. This red dot here is the total, is based on the current density of the converter that we released based on the TPS54A20. That's the part number if you're interested. But most products available on the market today are kind of where these diamonds are. These are kind of the current densities that you get, and this is, of course, my best estimate at what sort of current densities exist. I've looked at a couple of research papers as well, you know, from some CPES, Virginia Tech papers, and this is kind of what they were getting as their current densities. But what we're able to achieve is, obviously, is much higher current density. And one of the major reasons why we're able to get that much better current density is because of height reduction. So you can see with this converter, it's a very low profile. It's, you know, 1.2 millimeters tall. And if you compare that to the buck converter that I showed on the previous slide, you know, its height is dominated by this inductor. It's almost 5 millimeters tall. So we get very high current density. And if you prefer power density as the metric, this is, you know, 1.2 kilowatts per cubic inch, which is very high power density. Personally, I prefer current density because there's a lot of games people play sometimes with power density, and I think current density, you get the best, fairest comparison. Now, inductor size reduction is really helpful for, obviously, the size benefits, but like I was saying, there's also some cost reduction benefits as well. On the left here, these are two inductors based on your 10-amp buck converter operating around 500 kilohertz. On the right is the high-frequency, really small chip inductors that we can use when we're operating, you know, 2 to 5 megahertz per phase region. And what's cool about it is that you get, you know, if you look at these, if you look up this part number on DigiKey, you can even look it up yourself, the 1K unit pricing is $2-3. I think it's either like $285 or $325 or something like that last time I checked. Whereas these sorts of inductors, they're in the 20 to 30 cent range. So significant savings in both size, you know, 15 times smaller, as well as cost. So that's just the background. What I want to really address today is the limitations for operating your conventional buck converter at high frequency. What stops us, or what are the challenges we face? Then I'll discuss the series capacitor buck converter topology. Show some experimental results that kind of demonstrate some of the performance and benefits of it. And then a lot of people want to know at least a couple things about just some design considerations, and hopefully I'll address some of the questions that people bring up. And I'd be happy to entertain more if you have more. On the right here is just a picture of the prototype, one of the prototypes that we have. That's the IC, that's the series capacitor. Those are two inductors, alpha caps, input caps, and some other RSNCs and stuff like that. So why can't you use a buck converter at high frequency? And when I say high frequency, I think of the HF range, and that's 3 to 30 megahertz, as defined by, I forget the group, but things like ITAR, no. It doesn't matter, IT something. So when you want to operate at high frequency, as you guys probably all know, switching loss increases, right? That is the fundamental reason why people don't operate converters at higher frequency most of the time. The switching loss just becomes prohibitively large, and it outweighs any sort of conduction losses in the converter. But for these high voltage conversion ratio applications, there's another challenge, and that's really the high side switch on time. Let's say you want to operate this buck converter at 5 megahertz. That means you're going to have a 200 nanosecond period, right? And if you're in a 10 to 1 voltage conversion ratio, that means the on time of that high side switch Q1 is only going to be 20 nanoseconds. That's a really short period of time, and it's difficult to reliably control the on time for that switch. If you look at most converters on the market today, it's not uncommon to see, you know, 100 nanoseconds minimum on time. Now, there are some converters you can get down to, you know, I've seen 40 nanoseconds, 15 nanoseconds, kind of minimum on time. So they do exist, but it's very difficult to get, you know, much below that. So if you do see HF converters on the market today, they typically have low conversion ratios. They're really designed for low input voltages, you know, maybe 5 volt input or below. And they typically also have low current, maybe an amp or less. Now, the series capacitor buck converter is a unique topology that helps us to overcome a lot of these challenges. And that's what I'm going to spend most of the time focusing on, is how this converter works. You guys are probably familiar with a multi-phase buck converter, so this looks very similar to your conventional two-phase buck converter. The main difference is that we've added this series capacitor, and instead of connecting the drain of the high side switch in phase B to the input. We're now connecting it to the positive side of that series capacitor. So two small changes give us a lot of benefits. Another way to think of this topology is that we are merging a switch capacitor circuit with a two-phase buck converter. And we're doing it in a way that it occurs in a single conversion stage. So sometimes people will want to have maybe cascaded converters, whether it be a switch capacitor circuit or some, you know, any other converter topology, and follow it up with another one. But this is in a single conversion stage. You get the best of both worlds from a switch cap circuit as well as an inductor-based circuit. But the key of this topology is that whenever you turn on or off any of these power FETs, they are turning off, on and off. They're commutating with half the input voltage across it. Regular buck converter sees the full input voltage. These see half. So you get reduced switching losses as a result. And in the next couple slides, I'll go through how the converter operates. This is just to highlight them, so we'll get more details in just a sec. The other great benefit of this topology is that the capacitor is being charged and discharged in a soft manner. Basically, inductor A charges the capacitor and inductor B will discharge it. And inductors, as you probably know, effectively are current sources. So as opposed to your conventional switch capacitor circuits where you have hard charge and discharge because you're basically connecting voltage sources together. And in that case, you get these, you know, large impulses of current. And, you know, we have people in the room today that are like, you know, experts in switch capacitor circuits, so I probably don't need to tell you about that. But this topology kind of overcomes some of those issues, and you get the benefit of the soft charge and discharge. But probably the coolest thing is the automatic current balancing. So as you probably know, in multi-phase buck converters, you typically have to sense the inductor currents and have some control loop that forces the inductor currents to be equal so that you get even power sharing amongst the different phases. With this topology, you don't have to do that. And I'll go into that in a little bit more detail in a few slides, but it's automatic, it's inherent, and it's passive, which is really helpful when you're operating at high frequency. You don't want to have really high bandwidth, you know, sensing circuits and stuff like that. Another side benefit you get is that the on times of the high side switches are doubled as compared to your conventional buck converter. Now, there's no free lunch. Usually, I guess maybe you can find a couple free lunches if you're a student still. But there are some drawbacks. The main drawback is this. These two switches, the high side switches, can't be on at the same time. If they are on, you lose a lot of the benefits of the topology and stuff kind of starts to unravel there. So that's another way of saying there's a 50% duty cycle limitation. Now, when you combine that 50% duty cycle limitation with the fact that you basically have an inherent 2-to-1 step down with this kind of front-end switch capacitor type circuit, that basically means you have like a 2-to-1 plus this 50% duty cycle limitation. So theoretically, your minimum input voltage is 4 times your output voltage. Or another way of saying that is your output voltage has to be at least 4 times less than your input voltage. So if you wanted a 12-volt input converter and a 5-volt output, this wouldn't work. If you're looking for high conversion ratio, 12 volts in and some low voltage out, this will be great. Practically, of course, when you take losses into account, you're probably more looking at like a 5-to-1 conversion ratio. So, I know, I'm sorry, I wanted it to be useful in all applications, but today it doesn't. Maybe in the future it will. Now let's talk about a little bit about how this works. I don't know, have any of you guys seen this converter topology before? A couple of you have, okay. So, that's good. We'll share some knowledge today. So I have some fun animations that will hopefully make understanding this converter topology pretty straightforward. The switching cycle looks just like a conventional two-phase buck converter where you have the two phases operating 180 degrees interleaved. Here's the topology. On the top right, we got the inductor and series capacitor currents. This is the series capacitor voltage measured differentially. And down the bottom right here, we have the switch node voltages. So in interval one, we turn on the high side switch of phase A, and the low side switch of phase B is on. And the other complementary switches are off like you'd usually have. When you turn on this high side switch of phase A, you're connecting the positive side of the capacitor to the input. And I should also say that for this sort of animation, I'm assuming the 12-volt input. And the voltage across that series capacitor is nominally half the input voltage. And you can see that down here, it's roughly 6 volts with some ripple on top of it. So the switch node voltage of phase A is going to be 12 volts minus the 6 volts, or roughly 6 volts. And that's what you see over here. The switch node voltage on VSW A is 6 volts. And so you have positive voltage across inductor A. It's sloping up like you would usually see. At the same time, the inductor current is equal to this current that's going through the series capacitor. So the series capacitor current is shown in red. And basically what's happening is that inductor A is charging the series capacitor a little bit. That's why you see over here that the series capacitor voltage rises a little bit. Now we've selected the value of capacitance of the series capacitor such that we're designing it for relatively low ripple. We want it to be acting like a voltage source, essentially. Nothing too exciting happening on phase B. Low side switch is on, connected to ground. Phase B inductor current's going down, just like a regular buck converter, switch nodes at ground. That's pretty simple. Interval 2 is also relatively straightforward. Both low side switches are on. Both inductors have a negative voltage across them, and that's why their slopes are negative. The switch node voltages are at ground. And there's no current going into or out of that series capacitor, as you can see over here. Therefore, its voltage is not changing. Now, interval 3 is where things get exciting. If I had to choose a favorite interval, this would be my favorite interval. In this case, the negative side of this capacitor is connected to ground through the low side switch of phase A. And the positive side of the capacitor is connected through the high side switch of phase B to the switch node of B. So what that means is that the series capacitor is effectively operating as an input capacitor to phase B. You can see that the switch node voltage on phase B is at 6 volts, which is basically the voltage across that cap. And the phase B inductor is, the voltage across it is positive, so you can see that in green, that phase B inductor current is rising up. At the same time, it's pulling current out of that series capacitor. As you can see here, you have a negative current or current coming out of that cap. So the voltage on that cap, you know, slopes down a little bit. And phase A is just kind of hanging out like usual, low side switch on, so negative slope on your inductor current, nothing too fancy happening there. But as you can see, like, you know, phase A charges the capacitor, phase B discharges. Interval 4, same as interval 2, low side switches are on, inductor current slope, nothing going into or out of the series cap, its voltage isn't changing, switch nodes are at ground. I just joined that for completeness because you just do those same four intervals over and over again. So we are able to reduce switching loss, and I'm not going to go into all the details of all the loss components of switching loss because that would take too long and it's not really that interesting. The key thing here is this, is let's say we just take a look at the energy stored in the parasitic output capacitance of the FETs. If we turn on a FET with 12 volts drain to source across it, and with at least the FET that I was looking at and the data that I had, you'd have around 30 nanojoules of energy loss. If instead you turn that FET off with around 6 volts across it, you have about 10 nanojoules of loss. So you get around a, you know, 2/3 reduction in your at least that component of switching loss by having a reduced voltage. Now, usually we talk about zero voltage switching, that would be down here. So we get 2/3 of the way to zero voltage switching just by reducing the voltage across that switch by half. Now, caveat, of course, that's only one component of switching loss. There's, you know, many things you can look at. There's lots of detailed models that are out there from different people. You also get reduced voltage current overlap, and I won't go into all those details. The main point is that by switching with a reduced voltage, and this is very well known in power electronics, you get reduced switching losses, which enables us to push the frequency up. Here's some measured efficiency comparison. This is the series capacitor buck converter operating at 2 megahertz. This is a regular buck converter that we have operating around 500 kilohertz. And you can see that I get higher efficiency over the load range. This is for the same kind of 12 volt in, 1.2 volt out application. The inductors I selected were for an equivalent DCR. I tried to do that to just make the inductor-based losses not kind of come into the equation as best I could. And when I say equivalent DCR, that means the buck inductor, I think, had a 3 milliohm DCR, and the series cap inductors had like 6 milliohms of DCR, because they're only seeing half the current each phase. But anyway, the key message here is that we get higher peak efficiency even though we're operating at much higher frequency. The automatic current sharing mechanism in this converter is really cool, and I don't have time to go into it. I could probably just talk about it in and of itself. If you want more details, you can look at this paper. But the way it basically works is that the series capacitor helps to form this negative feedback loop. Because the inductors are charging and discharging that capacitor, and in steady state, periodic steady state, that capacitor, the charge balance must be maintained. So the easiest way to think of it is like this. If for some reason the inductor currents were perturbed, that one inductor current was on average higher than the other, what would happen is that, let's say inductor A was a little bit higher, then your series capacitor voltage would increase. And what the effect that has is it will change the average switch node voltage in a way that will then bring the inductor currents back into line. So the average voltage at the switch node of phase A goes down, and the average voltage at the switch node of B goes up, and that will then make the inductor currents kind of, you know, go down and up as need be. So it's really cool, and what's needed about it is that it's exactly what you want. You want average current sharing. You don't want equal peak currents, and some controllers, when they do current sharing, they have the same peak current. But the problem with that is that inductors, the value of inductance varies by, you know, 20-30% with inductors. So what we really want actually is average current sharing, which is perfect. And we, you know, I've done some tests. It's very robust to variations in inductance and DC resistance. And the reason why is because at the end of the day, it comes down to charge. And so if you look at here, I'm just kind of in a diagram kind of drawn two different inductor waveforms with, you know, different inductance values, right? So this one in blue is kind of a larger inductance value, so lower peak-to-peak ripple. In red would be less inductance, so larger peak-to-peak ripple. But what's important is the charge, or the area under the curve. So the area under these curves is independent of inductance. Inductance, you just change the slope. But assuming the same on time for both here, the area doesn't change. So I even show that experimentally over here. You can see that, you know, these are two different inductor currents. One's around 100 nanohenries, the other's around 200 nanohenries. And you can see the peak-to-peak ripple of the two inductors is significantly different. The average current is equal. And, you know, this graph over here basically shows those two inductor currents, average measured versus output current, and they're right on top of each other. Now, to get this converter to work, we kind of adapted one of our constant on-time controllers and kind of made a couple tweaks to it. Constant on-time controllers, if you aren't familiar, are kind of like a hysteretic controller where what it'll do is it'll look at your feedback pin, which is the scaled-down version of your output voltage, and it'll compare that feedback to some reference voltage. You'll have an error amplifier that triggers an on-time, and on-time is set to your high side to turn on your high side switch. Basically, it's the output voltage saying, I want some more energy. Now, there's an input voltage feed-forward block, and that basically is just there to set the nominal on-time of your on-time generator, and it'll vary with the input voltage. We also added this phase lock loop feature over here. It's pretty cool. It enables you to have some reference clock. It could be either provided externally or set with a resistor, set some internal oscillator. But what it does is you compare your reference clock with whatever the switching signals coming out of your on-time generator are, and you compare those two, and you can adjust your on-time in a slower manner such that your switching signals actually get locked onto whatever your reference clock is in both frequency and phase. But that only applies in steady state. So during a transient or sometime where you need to move your converter around really quickly, it'll still respond just like your conventional constant on-time controller, which is kind of hysteretic in nature. So it'll have very fast transient response. Personally, I think it's kind of the best of both worlds, but it depends on the application and who you ask. I'm going to show a couple results from this reference design. You're welcome to look it up if you're interested. Here's a picture of one of our of the reference design board, and designed for 12 volts in, 1.2 volts out, 10 amp at full load. Here's a general schematic. Solution size is very small. In this case, I think I actually had a capacitor that was larger than the inductors. I need to actually change that so they're not the largest, but that's why this one's 1.25 millimeters tall as opposed to the 1.2 in the other one. Here's just some efficiency and power loss curves if you're interested. This is for 2 megahertz per phase operation, 1.2 volts out, room temp, no airflow. We only had a two-layer board in this case. You can get, you know, over, you know, 90% efficiency with a 9-volt input and less than 3 watts of loss at full load, so that's pretty cool.
Now, a lot of people ask or point out,
well, you've reduced the size of this converter, and, you know, the losses are and efficiency is about the same. You know, thermals must be a problem, right? Like, how is this possible? And my response to that basically is that, yes, the size of the total solution has reduced, but really the size reduction was from the reduction in the size of the passives, not the size of the most lossy component. So what you see here is, here's some of the inductors. They're kind of shown here. They're not the hottest part. The hot spot is your IC. That's where most of the losses of the converter. And the IC, we really didn't change the footprint of the IC. It's basically the same as any other one. And the thermal challenge is basically the same there. But what we did is we reduced the size of the, you know, passive, so inductors and output capacitors and things like that. So you can do that without a problem because, you know, they're not the thermal bottleneck to begin with. That's not where your hotspot is. So I'm not going to say thermals is not a challenge. It always is a challenge. But it's not any more of a challenge, I would argue. Although you may disagree, which is fine. In this case, we have less than 35 degrees heat temp rise for this one. Load transient performance is very good, very fast. This is like a 50% or 5 amp load step. Plus or minus 25 millivolt deviation. This is the output voltage. This is the load current step. It settles in, you know, like let's call it 10 microseconds, which is very fast. Also, we were able to get very high bandwidth and phase margin. In this case, we're measuring over 300 kilohertz of bandwidth. Just let that sink in for a sec.
Isn't this constant on time?
It is a constant on time-based controller, yeah. So that does help. But, I mean, we sell converters that they're switching frequencies, like operating around 300 kilohertz, right? So, and this is just for the converter that's switching at 2 megahertz per phase. It's still pretty stable. You'll notice it kind of has, it looks, a lot of the constant on time controllers, they kind of look a little bit like a voltage mode where you can see like a double pole here. But then there's a, you get a zero and it, yeah, that's why it may look a little funky to you, but it's very similar to what you'll see a lot of our, even just regular buck converters that use a constant on time controller. The voltage plot's pretty much the same. This is taken for 12 volts in, 5 amps out. Now, I'll just quickly highlight a couple design guidelines and walk you through just a couple things if you do consider designing, whether it be this converter, really some of the stuff I'm going to say applies to any converter, right? So if you start with your basic equation for selecting your inductance, you guys all probably know this. You have to change it up a little bit for this converter, so you have, like, have to add a factor of 2 in because the on time is doubled. But the trade-off usually is, you know, picking what sort of value of ripple peak-to-peak you want in your inductor currents, right? If you want lower ripple or larger ripple, there's some trade-offs. Basically, it's, you know, if you have larger inductance, lower ripple, less inductance, larger ripple. Usually, I think of it as you're kind of tuning, you can kind of tune your efficiency curve. So for the lower value of inductance, you're going to have usually higher full load efficiency, but lower mid or light load efficiency, because In the full load range, that's when your conduction losses dominate, right? Whereas in this sort of medium load range or light load range, that's more when switching core losses, RMS current, some of those other things tend to dominate. It's not so much your pure I squared R losses. So there's some amount of trade-off there, and you can kind of pick your value of inductance depending on what you want to optimize for. Inductor size is also important. You know, that last comparison was assuming the same size inductors from the same vendor. This would be like choosing different sizes of inductors, and this may seem trivial to some of you. This is probably obvious, but I just thought I'd include it for completeness. Obviously, if you choose a larger size inductor, you tend to get lower DC resistance and better performance. Larger inductors, you can use thicker wire, so your winding resistance goes down, and you can really see that benefit in this mid to full load range. And this is measured results from same value of inductance, same vendor, same core material. So I'm trying to keep everything else equal here. But the real thing that the real place where I found a lot of difference was just with the inductor vendors. So this graph over here shows four different vendors. The efficiency I measured for this 12 volt in, 1.2 volt out, 2 megahertz per phase, overload load current. And you can see that the difference in efficiency is, you know, several percentage points, depending on which vendor. And this is for the same value of inductance as well as the same size inductor. So, you know, different vendors will maybe have different core materials, different construction methods, different things like that. So you, from my experience, I've seen that you can't judge an inductor simply by the DCR number that you see in the data sheet alone or something like that. It's a little bit more complex, so I always recommend if you have the option and time to experimentally test your inductors. The other thing I just want to highlight real quick is the series capacitor. This is probably the most unique thing about this topology, or I shouldn't say unique, but the thing that most people tend to have questions about. It turns out that there's a lot of topologies that have been in existence for a long time that use capacitors for energy transfer. You guys may be familiar with the SEPIC converter or CHOOK or ZETA or a bunch of them. Like, there's a bunch of converters that use capacitors for energy transfer, and we use it all the time. So have no fear, you can put a capacitor in your converter and it'll be okay. Generally speaking, in this topology, we are not using the converter to resonate. So as opposed to some other topologies where you're actually wanting, you know, that voltage to go all over the place, we're not doing that here. If you have a low value of capacitance, you will have larger peak-to-peak voltage ripple, a larger value of capacitance, less peak-to-peak ripple, right? So the general design guideline I usually give is you probably want to keep that ripple relatively small, maybe 5 or 10% peak-to-peak voltage ripple, because you want it to act as a voltage source. So for this example, let's say 10 amp load, 2 megahertz per phase, lowest input voltage of, let's say, 10.8 volts, 1.2 volts out. Here's an equation you can use to calculate it, and you get around a little over 1 microfarad of series capacitance. That's not that bad. 1 microfarad, that's pretty, you know, plain vanilla. They're pretty easy to get. In all of our converters, we're just using some simple multi-layer ceramic caps. I suggest using, you know, an X7R chemistry, just because it has 125 degrees C temp rating and all that good stuff. Now, you might say, well, that's pretty small. Why not make it, you know, 2.2, 4.7, you know, or larger values of series capacitance? And you can. There's nothing that stops you from doing that. In our converter, we have a pre-charge circuit, though, that pre-charges that series capacitor to half the input voltage. And the reason why we do that is we want to have a nice smooth startup. You don't want to have things going crazy. Basically, you're trying to set the initial conditions of the system. And when you do that, we just have a fixed 10 milliamp current source that charges it up. And so when you have a larger value of capacitance, you will just have a larger pre-charge time. So maybe you don't care about that. Maybe you do. Just keep that in mind. The other thing that you have to keep in mind when you're selecting your value of capacitance is variation over temperature as well as with DC bias. So it's pretty well known that as you vary temperature, your capacitance changes over temperature. Temperature versus capacitance change, percentage capacitance change. But the key thing really is how the effect of capacitance in ceramic caps degrades or it goes down as you apply a DC voltage to it. So in this case, you know, we said not only our voltage is 6 volts, right? So if we picked this small capacitor, this is like an 0805 package with less than a millimeter height. At 6 volts, you know, it's reduced by, let's say, 30-35% effective capacitance. So what you want to do is, you know, look at your capacitor data sheet to see what the effective capacitance is going to be. You can use a slightly larger capacitance. This is like a 1206 size package, and, you know, at 6 volts, it's not that much of a drop. So it kind of depends on the capacitor. Just double check that. The last thing is capacitor self-heating. With other capacitors that you use, you want to check what the RMS current flowing through that capacitor is going to be, and make sure it doesn't get too hot. It's pretty simple. There's a relatively simple equation for estimating what that RMS current is in the capacitor, and then check the capacitor data sheet or some online tool. I've plotted a few curves here of the temperature rise versus the RMS current in that capacitor. For this example, 2.2 microfarad cap, it's a 1206 size. At 3.3 amps, you get around a 16 degree C rise, which isn't too bad. But again, I suggest using X7R caps. This is probably one of my favorite slides to show, just because it shows the difference in size. Because many of you may not work in this particular space, you may not use a 12 volt in 10 amp converter all the time. But on the left is a picture of an inductor that one of our competitors, you know, recommends or uses on their EVM for their 10 amp buck converter, and it's huge, 10 by 10 by 5 millimeters roughly, or 500 millimeters cubed, whereas the total converter using the series cap buck converter that we have, it's, you know, 300 millimeters cubed. And I should also say this 1.8 millimeters is also including the PCB thickness in this example. So the total solution, input caps, upper caps, inductor, capacitor, IC, other R's and C's, that stuff, that's, you know, smaller than just the inductor used in a 10 amp buck converter today. So just to summarize, what I've briefly introduced to you today is some of the benefits of operating converters at high frequency, which you're probably already aware of. You get size reduction, performance improvements, as well as the potential to reduce your bill of materials cost. Buck converters today, I think, have some fundamental limitations that really limit their operation at high frequency. They have a lot of challenges that need to be overcome. The series cap buck converter, I think, has a lot of really unique properties that enable us to move to high frequency of operation, especially in high voltage conversion ratio applications. And I went over a couple design recommendations if you want to ever implement a series cap buck converter yourself. And it's relatively easy to do. If you're interested for more information, you're welcome to check out a couple different resources we have online. And that's all that I had prepared. I'd be happy to take questions or comments if you guys have any. Thanks for listening.
Where did the idea for the series capacitor topology originate?
The question was, where did the idea for the series capacitor buck converter topology originate? That's a good question. I first read about it in just research literature. Yes?
Wait for the mic. Is the capacitor, the voltage commutates across, prone to microphonics, prone to singing?
So it's operating at, you know, 2 megahertz. So that's out of the audio range. Is that kind of what you're getting at? like the
audible
noise. Yeah, so we haven't had any problems with that, just because, you know, the main, you know, it sees the switching frequency, essentially. That's
thank you.
Basically, yeah. If your load current was changing in the audible range, then you might see it.
I guess another way to phrase the question is this topology more likely to have microphonics than, say, a typical buck topology?
So my first thought would be is it's probably no more likely than you. I mean, you can still have that happen with your input caps or your output caps or something like that in a regular buck converter. You know, if you're operating, if there's something that's moving around in the audible frequency range, stuff tends to sing. So, yeah. I guess in this case, to that point, maybe you'd have another capacitor that you'd have to track down. But that's a good point.
Probably less likely to sing than the output caps because you've got an inductor in series, right?
That's true. The comment was, if you didn't hear, maybe less likely to sing because you have an inductor it's connected to. That's a fair point. There's another question back there.
Yeah, I was wondering, during the startup, can you control the voltage rise time speed up of the series capacitor?
So during the startup of the converter, what we typically do is we will pre-charge that series capacitor before we start switching of the converter, before we have the output voltage rise.
So that write time is 625 microseconds. Can you reduce that time or?
Yeah, sure. You just have to increase that pre-charge current. So in the chip that we released, we just have a fixed current. But I mean, you could make that current whatever you want it to be. You could change it dynamically. You could do all sorts of stuff if you wanted to. For simplicity, we just had a simple 10 milliamp current source.
I had a curiosity question. So you're showing something like 14 or 15 degrees Celsius rise in the capacitor?
Yes.
Is there any second order effects like change in ESR of the capacitor?
That's a good question. I don't really know, to be honest with you. Most of this temperature rise, I believe, is due to ESR. I mean, the ESR of ceramic caps are usually pretty low. It's around like 5 milliohms or something like that in this one. So it's not as sensitive, I think, because it's a ceramic cap. I think you probably have more issues if you use some other capacitor chemistries. But I don't know, to be honest with you.
I know people are hesitant to use coupled inductors because of the cost, primarily. But I think it would cancel out some of your other magnetics losses. It may complicate the problem. Had you thought about the complications out of that, or you just avoid it because people aren't going to buy them because of cost?
Right now, everyone looks at this and kind of the first thing they'll think is, wow, you've got two inductors and you could slap a couple inductor on this. And yeah, I don't see any reason why you couldn't. There's nothing fundamentally that stops you from doing that. We're just trying to only, bite off one thing at a time. You just introduce something totally crazy, we try to make it as simple as possible. Let me put it that way.
Okay. I mean, it's not like a Chuke where people avoided Chuke's original write-ups for coupled inductors, but almost everybody does it without a coupled inductor.
Yeah.
Yeah, my question is regarding the current balance.
Mm-hmm.
So I presume that the duty cycle in both phases should be the same to keep this going.
Yes.
So I couldn't figure out from your control circuit block diagram,
mm-hmm.
how do you generate the two interleaved on times, if it's the same circuit, or not, and how that affects the matching between the two types?
That's a good question. So the way it works is it's the same on-time generator, so it's the same on-time that both phases will see. What isn't shown here is there's basically a really simple circuit that alternates between A and B. So this will spit out a bunch of on-times, and then there's just another, I don't know what it is, real simple circuit that says, okay, this on-time goes there, the next one goes to the other phase, the next one goes to the other phase. So it just kind of spit, they are effectively getting the same on-time. Now, if these terms were to adjust really quickly, then you could maybe say, well, they're not getting the same on-time. But this is really relatively slow. It's got like, maybe 20 kilohertz bandwidth or something like that on it. So it's relatively slow. This one's also not that fast either. So in terms of the matching, effectively, they're matched. I honestly don't know what the speed of the voltage forward block is, but you make a good point that in order for these assumptions to be true, I would say we're actually leveraging a constant on time control architecture. If you had a fixed frequency controller where some voltage or current mode control where your duty cycle could be changing on a cycle by cycle basis, then you could see some more perturbations and more fluctuations in your inductor currents and capacitor voltage. That's true. So I think that's one of the benefits that we see of using a constant on time controller.
With that, we got to wrap up the Q&A. You can meet with the speaker after the event. Thank you.
Yeah, just to keep us close to 8 o'clock, and so everybody gets out of here in time, I wanted to thank Pradeep for presenting here, give him a little certificate.
Oh, thank you.
And so again, a reminder that we are going to have a presentation in the 17th by Seth Sanders. In the same venue here, pretty sure. It'll be in IEEE Grid. Just as a reminder, if you want to get the presentation, I just did a search for San Francisco Bay Area IEEE PALs, and if you go to the section under Archives, you'll see our last presenter's presentation, and it may take us a few weeks to get this presentation up there, but it should be there. And I want to thank you all for attending. Some sandwiches left over on your way out. Everybody wants a
grill. If you want to see the thing, you can look at it here.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.